election.
I fought before, but you do the best job with it. You've got the power to do it.
Well, I certainly wasn't gentle on them.
No, you weren't.
Camera two. Hello, Joe, what do you know? Jesus, wrap, you know, put it up a little.
30 seconds.
Good morning, not to be unkind. Joe Clark, you know, is much taller than Trudeau. Joe measures a good 6 feet, but somehow or other, he doesn't always look it. But he was on form yesterday, I'll tell you. Relaxed, reasonably so, informative to a point, and he's got a whole bunch of new promises for you. Mostly money promises on capital gains, this, that, and the next thing, deficits and whatnot. And I go through all of the national topics with Joe Clark. But first of all, I had a casual moment during the interview yesterday. Well, how's it going?
I think it's going pretty well. We had a great December, a not quite so great January,
no.
And we're having a great February.
Yeah.
As soon as the Prime Minister calls an election, we'll look forward with enthusiasm.
The not so great January, of course, referred to what the press called the frantic farce of the round the world trip. We deal with that too. So it's Joe off the top this morning after this break.
All that key light will do is just give you a very hot spot on the end of the desk right there.
That's right.
Right, I know. I've been here before.
We're ahead of you, Peter.
20-second count check.
That's why it calls the board audio follow.
Yeah, okay.
15.
There was a time, you know, when Joe Clark's Tories were 10 points ahead of the Liberals. Now they're more or less neck and neck, still with a big undecided factor of about 29%. But the common tum-tum is that the Liberals can't win the next general election. Here is a 30-minute interview with Joe Clark on major issues, beginning like this. Mr. Clark, precisely how confident are you that when the election comes, you will walk in as Prime Minister of Canada?
You never walk in, but we'll go in running with between 145 and 160 seats.
Do you think that your recent round the world tour, which was described by your friends in the press as a frantic farce, a fiasco, chaos, has damaged you seriously in the eyes of Canadians who had doubts about your ability?
No, I don't think so. I had a very good tour and a very bad press, and that's just part of what you have to put up with in this life.
Did you deserve the bad press?
I think that perhaps I should have spent more time with some of the journalists who were along. That's a lesson I've learned, and you always learn from these things. But one of the things I regret is that through my fault or someone else's, I was not able to communicate just how valuable I found the meetings with not simply the political leaders, but a lot of the business leaders I met in Japan and in India in particular, because there are great opportunities for Canada there, and I've learned things we can build on as a government.
We certainly got the impression that you were not very well informed on foreign affairs.
Well,
from the report, sir.
Yeah, I suppose the thing I could say is that either I wasn't informed or the journalists along were not reflecting how well I was informed because of any of a variety of reasons. I went over there, Jack, to learn about a part of the world I didn't know enough about before I embarked. I have come back learning with a lot more knowledge about Canadian opportunities in those countries than I started with.
Foreign affairs aren't that important to us anyway on the diplomatic level, are they?
Well, the diplomatic level is much less important than the trade level. There's a tremendous importance for Canada in international trade.
Where did you get that, Jack?
And not least for this part of Canada. You know, one of the things that has developed in the last 10 years is a movement westward of financial strength in this country. We've still got very strong financial centers in eastern Canada, particularly in Toronto, but Vancouver and Calgary particularly are very important financially.
No doubt about that, sir.
But what's important, and I won't take a long time on it, is that a lot of the money that is here and that has international experience looks to the Pacific. And I'm convinced that in a country like Japan, in countries like India, there are some very new opportunities that Canadian policy has to be conscious of so that Canadian entrepreneurs can go out and take advantage of it.
Domestic nitty-gritty.
Yes.
From the coast here, looking with some sympathy on the boy from High River, it would seem that you are riven with conflicts in your front bench. Two major conflicts, would you agree?
No, I wouldn't. I think, in fact, one of my great accomplishments, Jack, in the 3 years I've been leader of the party is that I've tamed the Conservative Party. We're operating as a very strong, disciplined unit.
How then do you explain the Sinclair-Stevens caper in the House of Commons right now, more or less? The Prime Minister cut down Stevens by saying, on a question about the dollar, I can see why your leader has demoted you.
Well, now, the Liberals are in some difficulty. They raised the question the other day about there being five economic spokesmen in the Conservative Party. Their problem is they've got none in the Liberal Party. And so they're naturally going to go at our very strong people, like Sink Stevens, like Bob Ducotre, like John Crosby, all of whom would make far stronger ministers of finance than Jean Chrétien does.
All right, let's clear away a piece for the record. You have been reported as saying that Sink Stevens will not be your prime minister when you form a government.
That's a false report. I have never indicated who would play what role in my government except for one portfolio. I've given the name of the prime minister.
That's the only one.
That's the only
that
one.
Is just, yeah. It's not even a misquote.
No, I've never said anything of that kind. I've indicated on occasions that there are a number of people who could do the job, as I just did now. Mm-hmm. But Sink Stevens is certainly one of the people I would be considering for Minister of Finance, mm-hmm. as is Bob Ducotre, as is Pat Carney, as is John Crosby, a lot of people.
But as has been mentioned yourself, there has been conflict between yourself and Stevens on your surprising statement about the stimulative deficit, which I'd like you to go back to again, but there was that conflict on the stimulative deficit when he and Darcy McHugh said, temporary means 1, 2, 3 months, all kinds of confusion.
I can't speak for Darcy McHugh, but I can for Sink. The position is this. We are going to move this country, Canada, towards a balanced budget situation. And we're going to do it by cutting two things. First, we're going to cut a lot of costs. I've spelled out the costs I'll cut. And incidentally, I'd like to have the Liberals start to spell out what they'd do. Would they get rid of Petro-Can as I would? Would they get rid of the Northern Development Corporation as I would? Would they introduce a policy of attrition in the public service as I would? The answer to all of those are no. But I've indicated where we would cut government costs. I've also indicated that we would cut government taxes because I want to put more money back in the hands of individual Canadians to get this economy growing. Now, there is going to be some period when you cut taxes because cuts cost money. There's going to be some period when there is a temporary shortfall in the money coming into government. Not because we're spending more, but because we're giving more back to individual Canadians to spend. And we're doing that because we think that's the way to get the economy growing. Within 2 to 3 years, I don't know if it's, as I said, I don't know if it'll be 18 months or 5 minutes, that stimulus we give to the private economy is going to mean that we're going to have much more growth in the country and consequently much more tax revenue coming into the government of Canada. That is the only way to bring down the deficit. That's the view that I hold. It's the view Mr. Stevens holds. It's one of the fundamental distinctions between the Conservative and the Liberal parties because we want to move towards a balanced budget and they are moving in the opposite direction.
Let me see if I understand you.
Okay.
Right now this year we have a deficit of some $12 billion and more.
At least that.
By wiping up Petro-Can, Northern Development Corporation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you'd trim by attrition about 60, or by direct slashing, 60,000 people from government service.
Over 3 years.
Over 3 years.
Yeah.
You'd give us a $300 tax cut as individuals.
There'd be an across-the-board cut to lower and middle-income Canadians that would average about $300.
That's $2 billion of revenue.
Yeah.
There would be the $5,000 mortgage interest write-off and the $1,000 municipal tax write-off on your property against your income tax.
That's right, phased in over 4 years.
Now, therefore, your revenues would drop to some extent. your money out to the individuals would grow to some extent, but are you telling me, Mr. Clark, that it would stimulate the economy so much that a temporary deficit would in fact help the overall economy?
That's clearly what happened when President Kennedy did exactly the same thing. He introduced much more significant tax cuts than we're talking about, and the result was that the deficits went down. And the results of the tax cuts we're talking about will be that the deficits go down. Let's just take some of those measures. Let's take the mortgage deductibility measure.
Right.
What that is going to do is encourage dramatically house construction and house purchasing in this country. We've got unemployment in the range of 22% in the construction industry in the country. You and I are paying for those unemployed. They want to work. They're not working. They're on unemployment insurance. If we can put them to work, earning an income, building houses, they'll be going off unemployment insurance rolls. That will be a saving to the government of Canada. They will also be contributing tax money. That will mean new revenues to the government of Canada. That's probably the most dramatic way of indicating what you can do when you give money back to Canadians to spend in a way that will make the Canadian economy grow.
Complaint, though. The $5,000 maximum mortgage write-off will generally go to the better-off middle-class people and not help the poor.
That's not true at all. Excuse me, but it's not.
Please,
we've taken a look at who owns homes in this country. Something like 6 to 7% of the home ownership in this country is concentrated among the so-called rich. Mr. Trudeau says that only the rich own homes. Well, that's not true at all. There are an awful lot of Canadians who are not at all rich, who either own a home or who want to own a home. And what we're trying to do is say that it is important for Canadians to have a stake in this country. And the easiest stake for most people to acquire most quickly is their home. We're going to help those people who want to help build the country by building a home. We're going to help them do that.
Now, you made an announcement at your fundraising dinner, which again will be interpreted as helping the rich in some ways. Please spell out for me your firm promise to relieve certain areas in capital gain tax.
We're going to take the capital gains tax off publicly traded shares in Canadian-controlled corporations. And the purposes are really, really threefold. First of all, that will stop the situation where a number of people who build up a company to a certain point and then need more capital have to go to foreigners. It will make more Canadian money available for those people to keep their company Canadian and growing. Secondly, it's going to mean that there will be a far greater opportunity for more Canadians who are now saving money instead of investing it to get into the Canadian companies and to invest in them. That, Jack, to me is very important to what we're talking about as a party, because if there's one fundamental theme that I want to follow as Prime Minister of this country, it is to get Canadian individuals participating in building the country. Now, you say it's only going to help the rich. That's not true.
Well, who buys stocks?
Well, that's a good question, because 40% of the people who now own stocks in this country, 40% of them are farmers or clerks or in secretarial work or identify themselves as members of unions, members of labor. 40%. And I'm sure that percentage would go up dramatically if it became the practice for ordinary Canadians to get a stake in their country by stock ownership.
Mind you, they were able to do that before capital gains tax was introduced, 7 years ago?
Oh, yeah, but there's a disincentive
8 years
now.
Ago.
There's a disincentive now, and what we're trying to do is remove that disincentive. I don't want Canadian tax law to get in the way of the ordinary Canadian owning something. I want Canadian tax law to help the ordinary Canadian
own something. So, therefore, in your first budget, Mr. Clark, you will put in a provision removing all capital gain from profits on shares in Canadian-controlled companies,
common
majority
shares,
or total. I mean, as long as it's Canadian control.
As long as it's 51% or plus.
And people will be able to buy and sell them and use the money in dividends or for expansion as they wish.
Yes, and I think what will happen is that a lot of people who have begun to become investors in that way will probably carry on their investment practice, and we will have, to come back to the phrase, a lot more Canadians getting a stake in this country. I'm going to be announcing later, I'm not going to give you the details now, but I'll give you a hint now, another program that we think is going to make it more possible for more companies to offer share ownership in the company to employees of the company. It works very well in the States. We're taking a look at a number of models, and that's part of our general program to help Canadians own Canada. Well,
still looking at our $12 billion deficit. 15 seconds. Money is the root of all evil for any Canadian Prime Minister who takes over now or the one who's in right now. You got to try and understand this tax business, this deficit business, and what, if anybody, anything can be done. Here's Joe Clark on it again.
Well, still looking at our $12 billion deficit under the Liberals and their total loss of control of the public purse. Agreed?
Agreed.
That's one of the big faults.
One of the major faults.
Will you clip McDonald's wings or will you give him more powers?
We'll give him more powers, and we will also open up government. We will end the tradition of secrecy that has been such a hallmark of the Trudeau years. You know, I think you and I have discussed before, one of the first things I'm going to do as Prime Minister is bring in a Freedom of Information Bill. And one of the next things I'm going to do is give power to the committees of Parliament. We've had a phenomenal situation in the last 2 weeks in the House of Commons. The Canadian dollar has been dropping out of control. The governor of the Bank of Canada admits that he has done all he can, and it's still going down. The Minister of Finance won't answer questions on the floor of the House. I've been trying to get a parliamentary committee given the power to call witnesses, call the experts.
American style.
American style, but very much necessary now. And they keep saying no. So it's a secret what's happening to your dollar and to mine. And we've got to end that kind of secrecy.
Mr. Clark, to be quite practical, I was talking to one of your backbenchers the other day, and he has the feeling, it was Huntington.
Mm-hmm.
He has the feeling that this vast government of today, with its bureaucracy and its power and deputy ministers, and with 10,000 million of capitalization expenditure planned, that nobody in God's earth can stop this juggernaut, and that to roll back, as you're going to try and to do, is going to be an impossible, and he wasn't being disloyal,
no, not
an
at all.
Impossible task. Is that not so?
No, it's not.
Are
impossible.
You not trying to con us a little bit,
no,
that you can really cut things?
No, I think I have never said that there's going to be a magic change the day after the election. But I am saying that there's a fundamental difference between the approach to government of Mr. Trudeau and myself. Mr. Trudeau thinks the state can solve almost any problem. And if you look at his record, he's had the state move in whenever there was a problem. I think there are limits to what governments can do, and that I think we get into real problems when governments go beyond their limits. Now, Ron Huntington has done a first-class job as the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee. I don't know when in the history of Parliament we've had a more aggressive or effective chairman. He's doing a first-class job, and he knows the problem. Some of the ways we deal with it are to give more power to the Auditor General of Canada. Make more public, end the secrecy so that journalists and politicians know what's going on, and begin where you can to get out to cut down government programs.
Yeah, very difficult. I forgot to ask you what the capital gain provisions would cost the Treasury.
Cost about, we estimate, about $50 million, and to be seen in terms of what
now,
that is about one-fifth of 1% of the revenues of the Government of Canada right now. The other question that I can't answer is how much it would generate. It would add revenues because it would increase the number of Canadians who are investing.
Funny how you can say that would cost about $50 million.
No,
it's not that much, is it?
Unfortunately, it's not that much. And that's why I put it in terms of the percentage. It's about one-fifth of 1%
right.
of our budget.
Here's one for you.
Okay.
Profits.
Yes.
Corporations.
Yeah.
Up 25.6% nationally.
Yeah.
In the lumber business in British Columbia,
yeah,
they're walking away with double the boodle. Double. 100% increase in profits. Incredible ones. Companies going from 17 million to 30 million. BC Forest Products, Macmillan Brodel. Incredible. The unions ain't going to stand for anything than the most substantial increase. We've already got settlements proposed on the coast here, 10% a year for 3 years. You might have to step back in one of these days with wages and controls again, wage and price controls.
I don't intend to do that. I don't intend to bring in wage and
price controls. Not in any circumstances.
No, I certainly don't intend to bring in wage and price controls because of the very bad experience we've had with them. They did two things. First, labor, quite properly, thought that they were being prejudiced against by controls. Secondly, the controls regime was one of the factors, one of the several things the Trudeau government has done that drove investment capital out of this country. On the profits picture, and in the forest industry particularly,
83-cent dollar.
Well, that there's a significant inflation factor in the profit picture that's there, and that's got to be taken account of. The other question that has to be asked, and I don't know the answer right now, but the question that has to be asked of the companies is, what are you doing with those profits? Are they going into somebody's swimming pool, or are they going into, for example, research to develop to make sure that we've got a reforestation program that ensures a strong forest industry from now into the future. My general understanding is that a lot of that money that is coming into forest companies now is being directed towards guaranteeing that there will be a forest industry in the future of British Columbia.
You're going to give, the federal government is going to give $235 million to these wealthy companies, $35 million out here, to these companies wallowing in big profits. We don't understand it.
My understanding from Frank Oberle, who's our forestry critic and knows this matter much better than I do, is virtually not a nickel of that is going to be new money, and very little of it is going to come to British Columbia. What they're talking about is redirecting so-called savings that they're spending in DREE and putting it into forestry. I think what needs to be done in terms of cooperation between the government of Canada and the forestry industry, and indeed the provinces, is to get together on an agreement as to the direction of research so that we can ensure that we've got forests in the future that will this industry
competitive. All the R&D for the big companies here is done in the United States.
Yeah,
those are all U.S. companies, bar one big one. Well, I'm glad you mentioned Oberle's name.
Yeah.
You probably haven't been told, but there was one significant trade union group not present at your dinner because of Mr. Oberle.
Yes, what?
That's the Teamsters.
Yes.
And Senator Lawson told me that he is most upset and his union by Oberle's private bill on right-to-work legislation, and that he, Lawson, had written to you and you hadn't answered, so he decided to withdraw his normal nonpartisan support for your dinner.
Well,
where do you stand on Oberle's right-to-work legislation, and is that a private bill or is that potential Conservative Party policy?
It's a private bill. I don't support the right-to-work movement, but I very much support the right of private members to introduce private pieces of legislation, and under my government, they will not be talked out. They'll come to a vote. It might well be that I'd get up and vote against Frank Oberle, but
would you?
Oh, sure. If his bill came to the floor, I would vote against it because I don't happen to believe that. But I think it is an entirely unacceptable situation now where Mr. Trudeau, because he doesn't believe with what a private member wants to propose, stops the matter from coming to a vote. He's muzzled Parliament in a number of ways, but that's one of the most dangerous.
Lawson said you didn't answer his letter.
I'll answer his letter, particularly if I'd known that it was going to mean that he would not pay money to come to hear me speak.
He might have bought a pit table for $1,250.
Right. Wish I'd known that earlier. I would have delivered it by hand.
Now, back to money again. I hate to be so pecuniary on this particular caper. Oh, we covered profits, didn't we?
Yeah.
And we covered your capital gain. Let's talk about the other conflict in your caucus. Do you remember Mr. Diefenbaker, sir?
I certainly do.
Do you remember special status?
Yes, I certainly do.
Don't you think that the average man in the pub, if he talks about Quebec at all in the West, if he talks about it at all, says, of course they're different. You got to negotiate some kind of deal with them. What's wrong with negotiating a deal with the province which Pepin Robert say is unique, different from the others? What's wrong with negotiation?
Federalism,
with Quebec.
Federalism involves negotiation with British Columbia, with Quebec. What you don't negotiate is the separation of this country. And in my view, sovereignty association means, it's code word for separation of this country. And I'm not going to negotiate that. And I think it's very important that Mr. Levesque and the people who are going in to vote in the referendum know that the next Prime Minister of Canada is not prepared to negotiate the end of the country. I'm certainly prepared to sit down with Mr. Bennett or with Mr. Levesque or with any other premier of a province and talk about means in which we can improve the way this country holds together. But I'm not going to negotiate
okay,
the end of it.
Don't lose me on that. This is a very tricky one,
yes.
Right? Who was it that put the foot in it? Was it Crombie?
David Crombie was the...
He put his foot in it.
About... That's right.
And you had to put him right on it. The fact is...
Well, look, now let's just be very, very...
I don't want to be unfair to Crombie. We don't know him out here, anyway.
Well, you should.
Some little fellow who's mayor of Toronto, or was.
Little fellow who was mayor of a big city and did it very, very well, and who's a first-class member of my team in the House of Commons. What David got into a problem of words, but the position that he supports and I support and the Right Honorable Gentleman from Prince Albert, whom you mentioned, supports, is that we don't negotiate the end of this country. And we make it very clear to Mr. Levesque before a referendum, as we will afterwards, that while there are a number of questions that we're going to discuss, including who has power over culture, including resource questions, the normal sort of thing that should have been discussed in the Trudeau years, but instead became a cause of conflict between the central and provincial governments, we'll discuss those, but we're not discussing the end of this country.
There's a funny bill in Ottawa just now about referendums by a national government. Ask Joe about that this time round. We start off with the premise that anybody could beat, some people think, Pierre
Elliott or Trudeau.
You don't really think this election is going to be voted on by the ordinary Joe Blow in Canada, not Joe Blow, on the unity issue, do you?
No, I don't. I think what's
going to... Or the Constitution.
No, I think the issue is going to be the economy and the need to have a new group of people to run the country.
You mean change?
Change. Fundamentally change, that's right.
Almost anybody could beat Trudeau now, couldn't they?
Jack, you probably could. I certainly can. I'm not sure that anybody could.
Yeah, but I mean, there's just a general cynicism in the nation about politics at large, is there not?
Sure there is, and that's a very real challenge for us, because one of the things that we have to do is create some sense of excitement and confidence about this country, because one of the real prices we've paid is that a lot of people who in the course of giving up on Pierre Trudeau, have begun to give up on the country. And what we've got to do is make it clear that this is a country where Canadians can build again. You know, we talked earlier about my celebrated tour around the world. One of the things that tour drove home to me was just how lucky we are to live in a country like this. Mm-hmm. You know, the Prime Minister says that we're doing as well as we can, that what we've got to do is lower our expectations. I don't buy that at all. We're not doing anything like what we could be doing in this country. You know, our rate of unemployment is the highest in the industrialized world. Our rate of inflation is higher than any place except Italy in the industrialized world. Now, we can do better than
your
that.
Your way to cut down employment is by incentive to business, freeing people from regulation,
yep,
and no massive spending of public works to prime a pump.
Well, not to prime a pump. There might be some capital expenditures. I mean, I'm not going to rule out absolutely capital expenditures. Some of those can be very, very productive. I'm not very impressed by lip programs and that kind of public spending. But there's certainly going to be some place in the economic policy we follow for investments that will build upon and cause growth.
And you'll be committed to follow the Trudeau disengagement with the provinces on shared costs, won't you?
Oh, well, we're going to. I'm not sure I understand what you're saying.
Well,
about
I'm saying
costs,
on things like medical costs, when the government begins to back out.
If the government of Canada makes a deal, we are going to honor that deal, and we're not going to back out the back door as Mr. Trudeau's tried to do on things ranging from hospital costs to the lottery arrangement. But I think the question of being able to get along between the governments is a very important one. He's got a track record of 10 years of fighting, and naturally, no provincial premier of any party is going to trust a guy whom they feel has been impossible to get along with for 10 years. I think that we're going to be able to carry into office, partly because we're new, a much greater ability to get the trust and get the cooperation of the other players in this country.
Well, I just want to go back to the Quebec-Levesque thing again. 2 points I really must raise with you. When I watched Levesque the other day, he's got no intention of making any sensible deal with anyone. He's out to smash the country, is he not?
Ah, but there's a way...
I mean, is that not what he wants to do?
There's a way you can deal with that, Jack.
I say on the air sometime, tell me if I'm wrong. Let's not forget, Levesque's ambition is to separate this country into two pieces come hell or high water.
You have to take a man on what he says.
That's what he says.
And he has said he believes in sovereignty association, and members of his party, when they define it, say that in effect means independence. So that's what I assume about the publicly stated goal of the Premier of Quebec. But he speaks for himself and for his government. He doesn't speak for his people. And what we have got to do is demonstrate to the people of Quebec that there is a middle ground between the separatism of René Lévesque and a status quo of Pierre Trudeau that just hasn't worked.
Are you not opposing the Liberal bill for a powers of a referendum on Quebec across the nation?
I'm against that particular bill because of what that bill says. I would be quite prepared to take a hard look at supporting a specific bill that gave the government of Canada the opportunity to frame its own referendum on that particular question of separation.
You mean you'll go for a one referendum bill on one question
where the question's
on
clear
Quebec
and approved? Yeah, that's right, and approved by Parliament. But this bill, this is a terrible bill that they've introduced. They've written it so wide that if the Prime Minister of Canada wanted to, with only 40 hours debate in Parliament that he can control, he can get his Liberal backbenchers up like trained seals talking the time away, he could have, for example, a referendum in the province of Ontario on whether or not British Columbia should control British Columbia's resources.
Or Alberta, more likely.
Or Alberta or Saskatchewan. He could have a referendum in one province, say Quebec, on whether or not there should be the continuation of the monarchy. He could have a referendum on whether or not we should continue with the Bill of Rights. He could have a referendum on whether or not we should take away from the Indian people of this country the protection that's in the Indian Act. Now, of course, he'd say
You mean he could do it province by province?
He could do it. He could have a referendum province by province.
I thought the whole idea was a national referendum on Quebec.
That might be the idea they talk about. That's not what their law says. And I want more Canadians who are enthusiastic about referenda to look at the exact language of what this prime minister is proposing.
Well, supposing he doesn't get this referendum bill passed in time and we don't have a national referendum in Quebec before Levesque does it, that may help break the country.
No, I think that if there was a capacity, if there was a capacity on the part of a federal government to bring in a specific referendum that would answer or set straight any confusion that the Levesque referendum created, that could neutralize whatever damage was done in Quebec. But let me repeat the point. This bill that he says is an answer to Levesque is a very dangerous bill because it's written so broadly. And I hope that many of the people who are watching us today will try to get a hold of that bill and just see how broad the power is. And remember that it was supported by not just every Liberal member of Parliament, but also by the New Democratic Party, because they are prepared to vest in the Prime Minister of Canada, a man whom I must say I don't trust, the right to establish that kind of question and hold selective referenda in selected provinces at his choosing.
Tell me, is this man, your good friend Peter Lougheed, is he not an extraordinarily wealthy and selfish potentate? Is he not the man who can cause more trouble over the control of resources than even Levesque when it comes to money? I mean, he's bulging with money at the seams.
He's not. The province of Alberta has become rich since the discovery of Leduc. And the province of Alberta, in my judgment, is prepared to meet its obligations under equalization and that kind of thing. I am not apprehensive about Peter Lougheed's credentials as a Canadian. I think he's a very good Canadian. He and I are going to disagree about some things. He's going to be the Premier of Alberta. I'm going to be the Prime Minister of Canada. And we will disagree, and when we disagree, I will uphold the national interest. But I respect Mr. Lougheed as an individual. I respect him as a Canadian, and I'm convinced that when I sit down with him, as when I sit down with Bill Bennett or any other Premier, in an atmosphere of trust, that we can work out any differences in the Canadian national interest.
Well, you certainly have the gift of the gab these days, Mr. Clark.
I've been learning it. There's a little bit of the Scot in me, Jack.
Scotch, yeah, we call
excuse
it.
Excuse you call it the Scotch.
I know that you don't drink.
No, I don't drink.
And I don't admit to drinking. Now, here's a serious one.
Yep.
I'm probably the only person in the country who thinks that this is an issue. Am I correct that the Conservative Party, under your leadership, along with the NDP and the Liberals, will vote for the decriminalization of marijuana?
What I want to do and what...
No, sir, I mean, that's a simple question. Are you in favor of the Conservative Party of decriminalizing marijuana, putting it under the Food and Drug Act?
What I am in favor of is ending a situation where a criminal record attaches to somebody who simply uses marijuana. I would want there to still be a penalty, but I would not want there to be a criminal record that would stop people from being able to...
amend the criminal code?
Well, we've got a proposal that would accomplish what I'm saying, that would keep the penalty, but would make it impossible for anyone to use that record in a way that would prejudice somebody who was perhaps some kid who went out with other kids and got caught one night in possession of marijuana. And you know how many people there are who've been caught in that kind of situation.
They broke the law.
Yeah, they broke the law, that's right. And what we've got to do is change the nature of the law so that it remains something for which they get fined.
Right, sir.
But not something for which they get penalized.
Agreed.
Their long
fine
life.
Them and give them no criminal record for the simple possession of marijuana.
That's what we're proposing.
Or even you could administratively say don't charge, providing you spell out what is simple possession.
And that's not easy.
That's not easy.
That's
but
right.
As it is now, sir, we're going to be in this ludicrous situation, if I may be forgiven,
yeah,
where it will effectively legalize the use. Effectively legalize the use. It will double in use by American state and other standards. But while I can buy my toke,
yes,
the guy who sells me three tokes can go to jail for 7 years.
I agree.
It's
that's
crazy.
Tough. I agree that's very tough. But I think you will agree also that there is a difference in fact between the person who uses and the person who sells. That difference exists in fact. Our challenge is to write that difference in law.
I
think it's worth facing that challenge to spare people who have been caught simply for possession from carrying a criminal record. I want them to pay a fine, but I don't want them to continue to pay a penalty through their life by having a criminal record attached to them.
But if you put it under the Food and Drug Act, you've got problems. However, there isn't a clean-cut, simple Liberal bill with which you now agree and on which you would vote with them and the NDP?
No, they haven't proposed a bill.
Will that be a high priority, a low priority, when you take power this fall?
It will be. We certainly won't be acting on it as the first item of business, but I would want it to be done within the first 2 to 3 years of a government.
Well, how's it going?
I think it's going pretty well. We had a great December, not quite so great January,
no.
And we're having a great February.
Yeah.
And as soon as the Prime Minister calls an election, we'll look forward with enthusiasm to government.
When you read some of that stuff, the likes of Fotheringham and Southern News Services, wouldn't you, when you're off the plane to go and clout somebody? Or were you that bad?
No, as I say, I had a good trip and a bad press, and that's something you just have to put up with in this
I hope we meet again on a plane going to Holder Resort soon.
That's too high, okay.
Joe Clark, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Met Joe one Christmas going to Hawaii, and there was Joe there too. Well, what do you think of that interview? He was quite specific on his financial propositions. 5,000 write-off, the 1,000 property write-off on your principal residence, the capital gains bit, the $300 tax cut, the 60,000 civil servants. So on the other issues, it's really not unlike fencing with Trudeau on the constitutional bit. But he came off not bad on that. I was probably too soft. Who knows? You do interviews as you find them. Did that yesterday afternoon. I'm going to put aside one segment right now. I don't want a bunch of partisan calls, but I want some short, succinct comments on Joe's performance this morning. Not my performance, Joe's performance. What do you think of him? Is he any better, any worse? He's certainly not Joe Who anymore. Webster and Ewer, one segment of short, sharp calls to the telephone numbers. The object of this exercise is to get from some of the audience a short, sharp, succinct comment on Joe's performance. Go ahead, please.
I think you handled yourself pretty good.
That's not the point. What do you think of Joe?
Very nice. I think he's real right on.
Okay. Go ahead, please.
I think good for you, Joe Clark. Right on.
Thank you. How about you?
I would say the tax on capital gains, if he exempts it, is going to do nothing but help the rich. And right now, the poor are exempt from $2,000 capital gains as it is. The only way to get people owning their own homes would be to lower the interest rate.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Clark, you said here that 7% of the Canadians are owning their own homes in British Columbia, or is that across Canada? Is that figure not false?
I think you got the figure wrong. What did you think of Clark's speech?
I thought it was a fine speech, and I have a little hope for the country now.
Thank you. What's your reaction to Joe Clark this morning? He was on film. He's not here.
This is one NDPer that realizes she just saw our next prime minister.
Thank you. What do you think about Joe Clark this morning?
Personally, I think he's a pompous sort of individual who I don't think is going to do anything different than the Liberals are doing for the country right now. And there is one thing he mentioned, though, that interested me, and that was on referendums.
Mm-hmm.
And my personal feeling is that I think it's time that the people had a little more say in the government, because I don't feel the government speaks for the people half the time. And I think maybe a few more referendums on issues might be the thing.
He made the point, though, that he was against this referendum bill because Trudeau could use it far too broadly, far too loosely, for provincial political ends and not the national ends.
Okay, that's maybe a risk one has to take if the people are going to have more of a say in the government.
But otherwise, what did you think of Clark?
Well, I wasn't really impressed with him at all. I think he's a rather pompous individual.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
I say hooray for Mr. Clark.
Okay, a supporter. Where are you speaking from?
Victoria.
Go ahead, ma'am.
Hello. I find Joe Clark eager to talk to us.
Yes. There are three calls on this line. Let's hear from the woman about Joe Clark. You find Joe Clark what?
Pompous.
Evasive.
And this first person, I and my, is getting to me, and I pray for St. Stephen's to do something to him like he did to Diefenbaker.
Like cut his throat?
Sure.
Thank you, ma'am. Where are you speaking from?
I'm calling from Kelowna.
Speak up, ma'am.
I'm calling from Kelowna, and I just wanted to say that I was very impressed with Mr. Clark this morning. It's the first time, actually, that I've really thought he came across as someone you could elect as a Prime Minister of Canada. I've just been always a Liberal supporter. And
thank you, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
I'm a dyed-in-the-wool NDPer, but I thought Mr. Clark came across not quite the buffoon the media has tried to make him out to be over the past year.
Well, he isn't quite the buffoon. He's got the unhappy knack of Stanfield had of dropping the football.
I know, but that's...
But I would say that some of the guys on the trip were out to cut his throat anyway. Even if he'd caught the football, they'd still have cut his throat.
I think they would have. I thought he came across very well.
Are you a Tory anyway?
Pardon?
Are you a Tory anyway?
I'm an NDPer, died in the wool.
Go ahead, please.
I was very impressed with Mr. Clark, and I feel I can trust him. And as for pomposity, I think you couldn't beat Trudeau for that.
I thought Joe was quite good, especially at the end when I said, how's it going, Joe?
Yes, I did too. I feel I can trust him, and I feel better about everything.
Thank you. Some little old ladies will sleep better tonight. Go ahead, please.
I think he's evasive, and I don't think he can be trusted.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster, I was really excited with Joe Clark this morning. I think, I know with Trudeau over the last 10 years, his philosophizing and confusion of the general public, I think it's really great to get straight answers, and somebody who's really going to get right down to brass tacks and get this country back into a good position.
Thank you. Were you always a Tory?
No, not really, but I definitely am now.
But what have I said to you? Look, compare the intellectual qualities of the sophisticated intellectual Pierre and ordinary Joe. Which one would you choose?
Oh, definitely Joe, because I think that's where the masses of the Canadians are at.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Jack. I had Joe Clark all the way, Pat Carney second, and Jack Webster third.
What do you mean, putting me third, do you think? Go ahead, please.
We appreciate you having had Joe Clark on. I think that he's really improved a lot, and I think he's ready to lead the country.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
I liked him very much, and especially the press that he got while he was away. He isn't as experienced and as slippery an eel as Trudeau, but I think we've had enough of that.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
I think he has improved immensely, and I'm certainly all for him. There's three of us here, and we're all for him.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm not doing a poll. I just wanted some reactions from Terrace, B.C.
Yes, I think Joe Clark will have something going for Canada.
Thank you. Where are you from? Lytton, B.C. From Lytton.
Hello, yes.
That's you, sir. Speak up.
Oh, yes. There are just two comments I would like to make, sir. That is, I think Joe Clark is sounding much more like a statesman than he used to. And the other point is that had I been he on his foreign tour, he was quite right to stress the business opportunities, which he has done.
A business of what?
On my return, I would have conceded Mr. Trudeau's greater experience in diplomacy, mm-hmm. but I would have made the point that all Mr. Trudeau's diplomatic experience hasn't done a hell of a lot for the economy of this country.
Good point. Now, that's all I'm taking on telephone calls, thank you very much. I next have a highly inappropriate segment, one segment only, with a guy who really wants to smash the country. He's from the Committee for Western Independence. Just one segment only, after this break.
It's the Western National Association that I represent, but we're...
You know, I'm a reporter, and I'm letting you meet all kinds of strange people. None stranger, perhaps, than my guest this morning after hearing Clark from Alberta, a fellow called Gerry Ronayne, who's a big shot in a separatist party, which is going to merge with our own little separatist party out here. We've got a Committee for Western Independence, Doug Christie, remember him? And now the Western National Association. Funny, you know, because the point I was making to Joe Clark this morning was that the most difficult man to control when it comes to natural resources ain't a vec. It's going to be the era billionaire in Alberta, Mr. Lougheed, isn't it? And you're with him all the way, aren't you, if you can do anything to make it difficult for a national government to get its proper share of the Alberta oil resources.
You said, you know, it's serious. Or did you say it was funny?
It depends on
your point of view.
All right,
but, you know, Peter the Great, as we call him in Alberta, he's running his own little show there, and I think his days are very fast being numbered. And the reason I say it
Come
is that
off it, Gerry. Who's going to number them?
he's numbered himself. He's lost over 9 of his cabinet ministers, and 21 of his MLAs are no longer running for re-election.
Yeah, he did lose 9 cabinet ministers,
exactly.
Didn't he?
If that isn't losing, tell me what is.
Yeah.
However, let me tell you.
Who's going to beat him? The NDP?
The Western National Association, that's the name of my party from Alberta.
It's a party?
Yes, a political
How many
party.
Members?
A couple of hundred.
200.
How many have the Liberals got? How many votes do the Liberals get?
They have a lot of Liberals.
So you get more votes than you have memberships.
What is the object of the Western National Association?
We're working for the independence of Western Canada.
Now, don't do a Levesque on me. What do you mean by the independence? You mean a separation from the rest of the nation?
If necessary, yes.
Not if necessary. Do you want sovereignty status for Alberta, or do you want independence?
We've got a sovereignty association now within Confederation. We have a sovereign's representative in Alberta, as you have here. However...
Oh, you're an anti-monarchist,
no,
too.
No, I'm not. Very much
the opposite. You sound English to me.
I was 20 years ago.
How many years?
I'm a Canadian now.
You're Canadian now.
Yeah.
So you come out here as a new Canadian and decide that the country isn't good enough for you, want to chop it into two pieces?
Oh, no. It's a super country for me. All I'm determined is that it stays the way it is.
Are you in the oil business?
No.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a sales manager.
Of what?
Construction materials.
Construction materials. All right. The objects of the Western National Association are to, put it simply, get independence for Alberta and British Columbia.
For the Western provinces. That's
what
the four,
are the Western
the
provinces?
Four Western provinces. Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and BC. And if the Northwest Territories want to come along with us, they'll be welcome. Now, we're joining with them, and there's a meeting tomorrow morning at the Landmark, the Sheraton Landmark, to formulate that marriage. That's the Committee for Western Independence.
You might get enough to fill two phone booths.
Oh, we'll have a couple of hundred people down there.
Oh,
because
yeah.
What we're really getting now is the people who are last coming out of what I call the separatist closets.
Have you made any serious study of this?
Oh, we have. In fact, let me tell you
are
that
you
our background...
Are you telling me that you have...
done our homework, yeah.
Just
I'm telling you
Levesque
we've done our homework.
Levesque wants to withdraw. Agreed?
Uh-huh.
Levesque thinks he can con the people of Quebec into the Sovereignty Association, an economic association of some kind.
Mm-hmm.
Are you telling me that constitutionally you now have the power, if you had the votes, to break Western Canada away without
certainly.
Reference to Ottawa?
Yes, certainly. And that's implicit in the preamble to the British North American Act.
Isn't it somewhat Let selfish for a nation which has been going for 108 or 109 years, and you want to take the Western storehouses of raw materials, the oil, the grain, the coal, what we have in British Columbia, keep it all for yourselves and the hell with the rest of the country?
We didn't say that. What we are going to have is a political center of gravity shifting to the west, out of Ottawa. And that's what we don't have right now. We don't have political representation of any meaningful magnitude in Ottawa. And let me give you examples of the people who've tried their damnedest to represent the west.
Real.
Everybody from John Diefenbaker down. And when he finally had played his part in the political spectrum down there, and it'll happen to good Joe Clark too, maybe, he was moved off center stage by the Eastern-dominated Federalist parties. And there isn't one of those Federalist parties right now prepared to take a stand on Western Canadian aspirations.
Why do you want to separate?
What we have to
then
do...
Don't give me that nonsense about Eastern domination.
No, I'll
what
tell you
is
what
the
we...
physical objective
okay.
of separating?
We want to be masters in our own house. And if we find that...
All
unpalatable.
Right.
Remember, there were 6 million Quebec people who voted in a party in November 77 for that very reason.
Okay, next question. We'll pretend for a moment I am even vaguely interested in joining your party.
Mm-hmm.
What is the political flavor of the Western National Association?
We're a right-wing party.
We're
a radical party. And by radical
right-wing.
Radical right-wing. And by that, it means that we are determined to make change to part or all of the parliamentary system, as we now have it.
You mean wipe out the vote?
No, I didn't say that.
Jack boots under the table?
Make changes. Right.
We'd still get a vote, would we?
Oh, yes, you would. You would have one vote, Jack.
Would
vote.
Would it not be proportional representation?
It would also be area representation. So we'll have population and area. We'll have a senior house and a lower house.
And you'd wipe out all this damned welfare state nonsense right away, wouldn't you?
Well, I am of the right wing, and you know, one of the advantages, you may recognize this, being an immigrant, is that you may recognize a great country of ours may go down the tube like some other places have.
Hey, listen, who's your leader?
We have a Doug Lowe, who's the chairman. He's in town for this joint meeting tomorrow.
Is he in the oil business?
No, he's not. He's a hog producer and fertilizer.
Have you got your eyes on any British Columbia cabinet ministers as potential leaders?
No, but I tell you what, there's a cutting that I brought down which I thought you might find a laugh.
Yes, I'm sure it'll make me laugh my head off.
Whitaker, the MP for Okanagan. If he isn't a separatist in the closet, I don't know what is.
How dare you suggest that a British Columbia MP would ever suggest such things. Okay. I don't know what George says. George is all right. Maybe Frank Oberle would give you a hand,
maybe
too.
Maybe he would. But there are other men from the West who have an independent
mind. Well, you're
a
member of the Conservative Party.
I was a member of the Liberal Party.
An executive or just
no,
a under
I was
the
one of the
member.
Workers. I helped get the vote out.
Well,
I've had background in two political parties before this.
In England, which one?
The Conservatives in England.
All right, for the record, you are Gerry Ronayne.
Right.
Of the Western National Association, which you claim is a party,
right.
And you're having a meeting with the Committee for Western Independence in two phone booths in the Sheraton Landmark tomorrow at what time?
10:30 a.m.
Thank you, Gerry Ronayne.
Everybody's welcome to come down and
put
your
shoulder
to the wheel.
I am not particularly sympathetic to your cause.
But, Jack, you would still be welcome to come if you can.
I won't come, and I advise people not to go. My thanks to Gerry Ronayne. Next, an old buddy of mine came in here this morning looking like a tramp. Have they got a camera on him? No, you'll see him on camera. No names, no pack drill. He'll stagger in a minute with three legs after this break.
Take your pick.
1 minute.
Rob?
I want you to come up here. Come on, camera two, and tell a joke. No introduction. Cue roll.
Okay.
Okay.
Somebody asked me. I said yes.
Yeah, but what would you sure
do? Just green.
We shot the camera this morning. One is down for technical reasons. Nobody has stolen it.
Down at the Queen Elizabeth Theatre.
30 seconds. Stand by.
Scott's fan.
Cue him. A little interview with the guy from Western Independence.
15 seconds.
Very good.
Stand
very
by.
Good. There's this Scots family, see? And father takes him out for a bang slap up feed, sausage, egg, and chips. And at the end of the meal, the little boy has left a sausage untouched on the plate. Father says, "Eat it up."
"I don't want it." "Eat
it up."
"I don't want it."
So father, in a bit of a temper, calls a waiter over, see? "Ga Kong." I said, "Could you wrap this sausage up? I want you to take it home for the dog." And the little boy says,
"What does that mean, we're going to get a dog?"
What? You didn't like that?
Very good.
I'm all this way.
Very good, Rolf. Rolf Harris is here for a reason this morning. Rolf and I are old buddies. And there's another old buddy of mine here too, Keith Matthews, who is one of the potentates of the Variety Club and has done some magnificent work along with Harris and everybody else. I've been one of the people who dodged the column up to now on the Variety Telethon. And Rolf is here because he's going to be on the Variety Telethon at the weekend.
I'm a bit jet-lagged at the moment.
Where did you come from?
London, and just 2 days before that flew in from Australia, so I don't know where I am or what time of the day it is, but I'll be right by tomorrow. Ready to go.
No didgeridoo?
I brought it, yeah.
You brought the didgeridoo?
I didn't bring it today. No,
I didn't want a didgeridoo. I've seen the didgeridoo before. Another joke, and then we'll get down to business.
Well, this isn't a joke. This happened in Aberdeen just recently, in Scotland.
Why pick on the Scotch?
Well, have you any reason? Have you guessed? Can you not guess? You, with your intelligence? I'm telling Scots gags because...
I'm
it's
Scotch?
A nice, yeah, Scots.
Scotch.
The Scots
tell
don't
a story.
Like
I like
people
it.
Call them Scotch. That's a type of drink. Jeez, I don't know. Been over here, what? How long have you been here?
31 years.
You see?
It hasn't lasted a bit.
Forgotten it all.
Oh, come on, last joke and done
it's
business.
Not a joke, it's a fact. In
Aberdeen,
they were digging, what do they call it? Excavating for a pipeline thing and about
for
6 feet.
For a what? A pipeline.
Pipeline.
A pipeline.
Yeah. And about 6 feet down, they found an 1862 penny. And about 4 feet across, they found a skeleton on hands and knees. It's fascinating, isn't it?
I know that. It's the old story.
Of course, they're all old.
Okay, down to business. When does the telethon open?
Saturday.
8 p.m. Saturday night, 21 consecutive hours, live from the Queen Elizabeth Theatre to 96% of BC TV's, the British Columbia population.
Right. How much did it raise last year?
$1,154,000 pledges, $1,180,000 in the bank.
In other words, $26,000 more than was pledged came in with the checks and the cash.
Exactly.
What have you done with the money, Mr. Matthews? Look at the camera and
we
answer the question.
We have committed, on behalf of the contributors from all over British Columbia, over $800,000 to Children's Hospital. We have spent the money in many other directions for our Sunshine Coach program. There are 13 Sunshine Coaches, which were contributed to various organizations in British Columbia. We have helped situations like the Vancouver Oral Center for the Deaf here in Vancouver and many other organizations here in Vancouver with the purchase of audiovisual equipment. Things that play an important role in the treatment and development of less fortunate children.
And there's no end to the need.
Never any end to the need. We'll move very directly as soon as we accumulate the $5 million we need for children's by 1980. We'll move into another major project. This will be identified for the public very soon.
In 15 seconds, we're going to meet a friend of yours with whom you did a very touching interview the other morning. Just a delightful little piece. And we'll watch the monitors and we'll see it and you'll tell me what the score is on it. Delightful little piece with a delightful little guy.
They tell me you like hockey, too.
I love hockey.
Is that your favorite sport of all sports?
Montreal Canadiens.
Montreal Canadiens. What about the Montreal Canadiens?
I mean, that's what I said.
Well, do you like them?
Uh-huh.
Is that your favorite team?
Mm-hmm.
What about the Vancouver Canucks?
Vancouver Canucks, they're my hometown team.
Is there a player on the Montreal Canadiens or some other team that you like?
There's one that I really like. He scores almost all the goals.
Who for?
Montreal.
Do you know his name? What's his name?
Guy Lafleur.
Guy Lafleur? Mm-hmm. You think he's pretty good? Well, okay. What can you tell me about this problem that you have? I understand you have something wrong with your spine. Can you tell me anything about it?
I have spina bifida.
Spina bifida. What do you know about spina bifida? There are quite a few boys and girls have spina bifida. And when they have it, they get a lot of help, do they?
By the treatment center, the children's hospital. Plus, I bet they'll get a lot of help from this new one yet, too.
And when the new one's built in 1980, I think we better put that one back up here a little bit. When the new hospital's built in 1980, mm-hmm. Do you think you'll be coming to it, too? Maybe you'll be all better by then.
I hope so.
Okay. Tell me about...
How old is Kevin?
That young man is 7 years old, Jack, and he is a remarkable young man. He's had 12 operations since he was born, and I think, as you saw by the interview, he's symbolic of the many young children in British Columbia that turn us on in Variety Club. He's the kind of man that we figure we should be helping.
He is as bright as a pin, isn't he?
When do you see him Saturday night? He'll be there.
He'll be there Saturday night?
Yes, he will. Yeah.
Well, I am going to be there Sunday afternoon. You know, I can't stay. I'm not allowed to stay up all night anymore. I'm too old.
So you say.
Well, no, that's the truth, I'll tell you.
As Rolf will tell you, once you get down there, it's difficult to leave.
Yeah. We're going to miss Wasserman this year.
Very much so. Jack was one of our great supporters.
Yes,
last year was the first year he missed his telethon.
Dear old Jackie boy. Well, Rolf, what are you going to do? Are you on for the whole... You're not on for the whole... How many hours is it again?
21
hours. On and off?
Judging by last year, you go away for a sleep in the middle of the night, and I did last year anyway. I got there and I was so high on adrenaline because it's a very exciting thing to be on.
It's the only drug I recommend.
I couldn't really sleep. I got back to the hotel and I just lay there and stared at the ceiling for about an hour, and then I got up and had a shower and came back in again.
And
a lot of your old friends will be with you this year, too.
Yeah,
who?
Ronnie Prophet's on.
Oh,
Bob
Ronnie
McGrath
Prophet.
From Sesame
Bob
Street.
Bob McGrath.
Now, there's one of the great performers. Gloria Kay is going to be in from the East. Real bouncy.
Lovely, isn't she?
Oh, yeah, and great talent. Great talent. Of course, some new people that we're bringing in this year. We'll have
a girl from
young
Hawaii.
Lady by Carol Kay from Hawaii.
Yeah.
All kinds of people. The younger element in British Columbia will be absolutely thrilled to hear that the Keene brothers.
Yeah, I met them.
Now, this is a Los Angeles group, and I understand, I have not heard them myself, I must confess, but I understand that they're just one of the greatest things. And so they're going to make things bounce around there. And Jack, as you know, they have a little bit of Western, they had a little bit of rock, they have a lot of Rolf Harris, they have a lot of Bob McGrath, and it's one of the most versatile entertainment packages, I think, that has ever been produced in Canada.
I tell you, the biggest excitement is to watch that total growing, though, on top of watching the people
entertain. Who does all their country work on the stage?
Well,
I mean, who are these people?
Let's talk about the real important aspects, the things that happen behind the scenes. I think Rolf will agree with me. We involve more than 2,000 people.
We shall talk about that, gentlemen, after this short commercial break. Rolf Blink brings in the money and the others and everybody else with all their efforts, but tell me a little bit about how you handle it. How many people work behind the scenes in the telethon, which starts 8 p.m. Saturday through 5 p.m. Sunday nonstop at the Queen Elizabeth Theatre?
We started identifying committees as early as first week in December. More than 2,000 people, tinker, tailor, soldier, sailor, get involved with the backstage actions necessary to bring a telethon to fruition, mm-hmm. so that Rolf and the massive array of talent that we've accumulated can ask British Columbia for help in building these major projects. This includes every facet of the telethon, the accounting thing that you mentioned, Jack, the transportation thing. We have to get people to and from the theater. We have to bring them in from all over the place. It's a massive coordination job, and it all works, and by 8 o'clock Saturday night, we'll be ready.
How many years have you been doing it now?
This will be the fourth one I've done.
The fourth year?
Yeah.
You fly in from wherever throughout the world to get here.
Yeah, the first one I did, I stood on the sidelines most of the time because I was waiting for somebody to say, it's your turn now, and I was like new boy, didn't know what the hell to do. But the second year, I was watching the guys the previous year and realised that if you've got something to contribute, you get in there and you do it and you get off. It's got to be short segments because they obviously want to keep the
thing moving.
Before the public that they want that money in.
Let me tell you a funny little story about Rolf. His first telethon. Leonard Nimoy was one of our hosts.
Oh, he's
or the guy with the ears.
Yeah, Leonard does a fantastic job. He's well associated with all of our projects. Rolf went on, and as you know, he's got a talent which is...
Bubbles.
I think it can't be paralleled with most other people. He got on and he started entertaining people. And he didn't really understand that the way of the telethon was just to give him a little bit of entertainment and then say, okay, now we got to make those phones ringing. We looked up in the middle of his act, there wasn't one phone ringing. And here was Nimoy.
Painting and singing a song, and Leonard Nimoy was going mad, saying, get him off.
And so he got him off. Rolf and Nimoy had a talk, and so when he went on to do his next shtick, he was standing in the middle of the stage, he entertained for 2 minutes, and he stopped, and he says, now I'm not going to do one more thing until you phone 688-5522.
Still, but you learn.
Yeah, I can see that. Look, any calls from anybody on the telethon? Wouldn't mind a few telephone calls on the telethon. Some are all sold friends. Even Keith has the odd friend, too.
I have some of the even friends, too.
We've got a project possibly for Christmas time. I'm trying to organize a premiere, North American premiere, in Ada Variety Club here in Vancouver for a film that I'm making in Australia, which is... I play the role of a very old guy. Let me show you the picture.
You showing the picture?
There's a couple of little tiny ones hopping. Where are you? Oh, there. That's where
I thought I was going to go on camera
well,
one.
Who's going? Oh, where is he? I'm
one.
Sorry, they're mucking.
Yeah, it's camera one. Camera one.
That's the character I play. You see, I've got the beard is all dyed white and I've got a white wig.
Are you supposed to be an old man there?
Yeah, you can't tell any difference.
Would you put the pictures down?
You rocker.
Will you take them on camera too? Close?
Young, lovable.
Can you take them close on camera too? Look, he looks just as old there. You didn't even have to make up for the part. What part do you play in the picture?
I'm a sort of a link man explaining the story and talking to camera. It's a story about convicts in Australia in the old days.
I thought you were trying to forget that in Australia.
No, actually, it's like Canada. We're about a couple of hundred years old.
Whisht. That means be quiet, please.
Whisht, lad.
Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Rolf?
Speaking.
Speak to Rolf, please.
You hear it? Yes, speaking.
Rolf,
speaking.
You're one of the few genuine entertainers in this market today, sir. I have a great respect for you. But I wish you would change your jumper. You come off the plane last night in the same one.
You were there, were you, cheeky devil? I changed a shirt, at least.
And I didn't see anyone rushing, but I have a genuine like for you, and I think you're a great entertainer.
How nice, thank you.
Thank you. From Prince George. Go ahead, please.
Ralph Harris.
Yes, speaking.
Okay, I'd like to know how come you don't draw or paint any more pictures, and why don't you auction them off when you do them on this telethon?
Well, it's a long, involved process auctioning them at the time. What we usually do with those paintings is auction them at a later date and put the funds into the telethon. It would take up too much time for a very small segment.
Good question. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to say hello to you, Rolf, and I've seen you in Edmonton and telethons there, and I'm kind of looking forward to seeing you here.
Good one, good.
I'd like to ask just one question, and I hope Jack doesn't think I'm being mean or anything, but how much money are you... is the group trying to raise this year?
We're trying to, what we've done, we've committed, the Variety Club has committed themselves to raise $5 million towards the Children's Hospital, and we never set a target for a telethon, because if you reach that target, everybody stops ringing. If you don't reach that target, everybody's disappointed. So it's silly to say we're trying to raise $1 million. We're trying to raise whatever we can raise each year until that $5 million is paid. The Variety Club is committed to raise that.
Good policy.
Short one, Jack, if you don't mind.
Sure.
How much, like, now, do you have a percentage basis on how much money it took last year and how much goes towards administration costs and things like that? I know that's, I hope you don't think that's wrong, but I just like that.
Oh, fair enough, Keith Matthews.
Oh, I think it's a good question. I'm glad to have the opportunity to answer it. Less than 2%. Variety Club has this knack of, bring Rolf in. Sometimes before we bring him in, we say, Air Canada, have you got a free pass that we can use? A lot of times the answer is no, but many times the answer is yes. And so we have a flexible administrative policy which tries to keep the price of our operations down so that all the kids can get more. And don't forget, we invest our money until we turn it over. So by the time we turn it over, the chances are we're turning over more than we actually have pledged.
That's a great cause, and I guarantee you you'll make it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Morning, Jack.
Morning.
Good morning, Rolf.
Good morning. Good morning.
Morning, Keith.
Tell him no.
We'll overlook that.
Keep going, yeah.
It's Mike. Tell him nothing.
Tell him nothing. It's Mike. What are you doing back?
Just got back.
Give us a laugh so I know it's you. Michael Mead, he's a super guy.
Mike, you know,
Mike? Yeah, he's just come back from...
Oh, Mike used to be me driver.
Right.
Hello, Mike. Thanks super for calling. Good.
Bye-bye.
See you over the weekend, probably. Lovely story. Not tellable. Never mind. Too busy. Go ahead, please.
Morning, gentlemen.
Yes,
morning.
Ma'am.
I've been listening to the advertisements for the telethon on the radio and on the television programs, but I've never heard Bob McGrath's name mentioned until just now. One of the gentlemen made passing reference to him. He is coming, is he?
Bob McGrath will be here in all his glory with Big Bird and a very strong Sesame Street flavor, and as you well know, ma'am, he puts on a children's hour the likes of which has not been seen here in many years.
Absolutely beautiful.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Good morning. I'm a New Zealander sitting in a hotel watching this program, and I'd just like to say hello to Rolf.
Rolf? Trust you get the name right. Rolf it is. How are you?
Well, it's just my dialect, you see. What I want to do is to issue you a challenge to try and get these British Columbia boys to come up to $1 a head like New Zealand did. They got $3 million on their telethon, and that's pretty near a world record, I reckon. So will you get cracking and get them $1 a head out of British Columbia?
That's not a bad suggestion.
That's a good suggestion. I should like to respond to that there are variety clubs all over the world, and we're working on having one in New Zealand or Australia, as the case may be.
There is one in Australia, variety club.
There is now, Rolf?
Yeah.
That's good to know. There are 11 telethons held throughout the variety club spectrum, and the largest variety club telethon in the world is the one right here shown on BC TV.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, that's all the phone calls I can take. Rolf, thank you very much for dropping in this morning. Keith, I hope to be with you Sunday afternoon to do my little bit one way or another at the telethon for all...
You won't wear all that makeup, though, on stage there, will you?
Are you casting any nostrums at me?
Even if he does, we'll take him. We love him.
Telethon starts 8 p.m. Saturday night, continues non-strop through 5 p.m. Sunday.
She's getting very stroppy.
As much as possible, as quickly as possible. And we'll see you on the telethon. And my thanks to Rolf Harris and to Keith Matthews.
Good one.
Got a pledge in. Keep your pledges for Sunday.
Okay.
20 seconds, isn't there?
It'll be about 20 seconds before he gets into the first letter.
Is it split screen or across the way?
Is it a split screen or...
You bring that round?
Yep.
Very good.
Excellent. Rolf is sitting here to do a little gimmick in a minute or two, but first of all, I must dispose of some business. I want to take a chance and tell you to watch W5 on Sunday night. It's after American Graffiti. They're doing a shot on me. They may cut my throat. But first, I want to get into a couple of letters which I think must be aired about Webster's program in general. And this one comes, the first one up comes from Seashell. I want you to read it. Would you please inform Mr. Webster that he is failing English again? He must not say, I feel badly about that. For he is then stating that he does a bad job of feeling. Would he say, says this person, I feel awfully or lousily today? How he feels requires modification by a predicate adjective, not by an adverb. Ask him to check his basic English and try harder. Comes from a woman with a beautiful name called Marcia Poultice. And in the Peninsula Times, she wrote, watching and listening to Jack Webster is insufferable. He sounds exactly the way Gordon Sinclair would sound if he had undergone a sex change and become Anita Bryant. Thank you, Marcia Poultice. A serious one to which I plead minorly guilty. Webster, your recent interview on TV with MacDonald, the Veterans Affairs Minister, is coming up now, was a disgrace from start to finish. You apparently found the whole thing a great bore. Prior to your interview with Mr. MacDonald, I know that you had many letters giving you some real facts about the Memorial Pavilion for Vets in Victoria. Mr. MacDonald had been fully aware of them for some time. Both of you most carefully kept away from the subject. Did you by any chance, this is to me, fight for your country? I rather doubt it. You had a wonderful opportunity to speak for the veterans at the Memorial Pavilion. Your show did not show either interest or compassion. The letters I got about the Memorial Pavilion, I got shortly after Mr. MacDonald, the Veterans Affairs Minister, was here. I plead guilty to not raising them with the minister. I shall look in detail at the problem in the future. Now, here's one which objects very much, and it's from Vancouver, and it comes to my particular attitude about judges and whatnot. You seem to be coming down heavily with a holier-than-thou attitude. Probably you, Webster, don't realize it because the public encourages this condemnatory stand. At heart, I feel you're a very fair and just man. I'm sorry to see you not examining each side of a question. Sometimes I can almost see you, if we go back several generations, standing in the forefront, shouting, off with his head. Some truth in that, I suppose. I tend to take a straightforward, moralistic position, but somebody's got to. Can't weasel all the time, whoever you are, I haven't got your name here, who wrote from Vancouver. One last letter, a little more humor in it. This is from one of those, one of mine, one of ours. For God's sake, man, can you no find a nicer theme tune than that awful bit of junk you are presently playing? How about a nice pibroch played by a real Gleska Keeley? And that came from Arthur and May Johnson.
Gleska means Glasgow. I don't know whether you knew that.
Pibroch means a whale.
Bagpipe, is that?
No, a pibroch is a tune. It's not a bagpipe,
man.
I thought
pibroch was the bagpipe.
No, a pibroch is a form of tune.
Didn't know that.
For the pipes.
Listen, I've got
Hold your breath.
Oh, can I do it?
Till after the break.
Right.
But if you go to the lawyer's office and speak, ask him. Okay. And give him the check. Not he doesn't need the copy of the summons. Okay. Call me after you've been there. Right. Bye bye.
Yeah.
Hi.
What's he doing? 1 minute.
I'm going to say something about it.
Yeah, you'll just take your time.
I'll take my cue. Linda.
Yeah. No. Shaughnessy.
All right, Shaughnessy. Next week we're going to be hammering you.
I'm still going on that tune that we went out on, that well-known Scottish tune.
Linda, next week, how does it look?
Next week, we'll be taking a look at Shaughnessy Hospital, talking to a member of the Teamsters, and also Robert Andrus will be in town.
Oh, and Teamsters for Democratic Action, and then the other side from the other Teamsters. Should be a good active week, and Brian's got a few things up his copious sleeves. What are you doing still here?
I was going to have a go at you for referendums. The plural of referendum is referenda.
I did not say referendums.
You did, when talking to that previous guy this morning.
What previous guy?
The previous guy, the deputy.
Joe Clark?
Yeah. Is referendums so? Twice on that program.
Is that so? Twice?
Yeah,
I said it twice.
Yeah.
What time is the thing on telethon on Sunday?
It starts at 8 o'clock Saturday, goes
8 o'clock.
Right through until 5 o'clock.
Sunday. 8 o'clock
21
Saturday.
21 hours.
21 hours. Should be good fun, shouldn't it?
Should be good, yeah. I was, there's a little film here.
You
know the film
seconds.
I was talking about? Oh.
That comes up in a couple of minutes.
This is one that I
nice to see you back.
Did on
you certainly cause a lot of noise around here. See you Sunday. Everybody else will see you Saturday.
Trying to get a word in edgeways. See you then.
15 seconds for your didgeridoo.
Oh, I see. Well, this is a song that I first sung on BC television.
You're joking.
Yeah.
We're going to hear it now.
And it's in this film that I was telling
you
about.
We're going to hear it now. Jolly good show.
We may, yeah. All right, old son?
Yes.
Right. He sat on the corner of Bevington Bush, astride of an old packing case, and the dolls on the end of the plank were dancing as he sang with a smile on his face. Come day, go day, wishing me heart for Sunday, drinking buttermilk all the week, whiskey on a Sunday. Were you singing then? I couldn't hear you from over here. His tired old hands beat the wooden plank, and the dolls, they danced the gear. Was a much better show than you ever would see at the Pivy or the New Brighton Pier. Now, come day, go day, wishing my heart for Sunday, drinking buttermilk all the week, whiskey on a Sunday.
Excellent.
Good little song, isn't it? Well, especially lovely when the crowd sing it with you. You know, it's such a moving feeling.